Hi, there is a particular topic I've been interested in for a very long time. There are two major nuclear reactor accidents that have happened so far in the world, in Chernobyl and Fukushima. Today, I'll dive in details on this and try to find some similarities. I'd like to apologize in advance to the experts or those related to the topic. I'll try to put complicated things the easiest way possible. I do know the terms like operative reactivity margin, subcritical states, but I'll skip that science in my explanation. On first sight, there is nothing common between Fukushima and Chernobyl accidents. The trigger was the earthquake at the Honshu's east coast. The epicenter of the 9-point earthquake was on the Pacific Ocean floor, 120 kilometers away from the nuclear power plant. The plant systems were operating normally. Upon the first earthquake shocks, all three generators were shut down. The shock destroyed the power line communications, and the plant's power was off. Such conditions had been foreseen, so the autonomous diesel power generators started. No further destructions came. The plant honorably survived the most powerful earthquake in Japanese history. But it was just the beginning. The shock caused two massive tsunami waves. The first wave, 4 meters high, reached the plant 40 minutes later. A second one, 15 meters high, flooded the plant an hour later. The water went over the protective wall and disabled all the generators. Ironically, the power plant was left with no power. Its rooms went black, so did all its indicators, controls, and communications. The staff lost control over the scorching reactor's cooling. With the help of pocket torches, they were trying to find the instructions, but there were none for a full plant blackout in the possible emergencies list. The accident started to gradually progress into a disaster. The irony here is that 25 years prior to that, in Chernobyl, engineers had been testing a system that would let a plant to work autonomously with no external power. The Chernobyl accident was completely handmade, though it is impossible to name the guilty ones. The development of a complex system is always a quest to find the right balance between simplicity, reliability, and usability. The design compromises had led to the situations that made the reactor behavior unpredictable. The basic working principle of a nuclear power plant is similar to that of a steam machine. The difference is that, rather than turning water into steam by burning coal, it is heated by uranium fission. The radioactive fuel is held in vertical containers, fuel assemblies. Inside them, water turns into overheated steam, which spins turbines, thus producing electricity. Controlling the steam machine is simple. Adding more coal increases the power output, while stopping to rebel decreases it. Reactors are controlled in a different manner, with the help of boring rods. This material consumes neutrons, so the chain reaction, impossible without them, stops. The rods move in reactor's active zone. If the rods are fully lowered, the reaction is stopped. The reactor is inactive. The more the rods are pulled from the reactor, the more aggressive the uranium fission, and the more heat is generated by the reactor. A reactor operator's task is to keep the reaction stable, so the uranium fission is roughly constant. The rods in Chernobyl power plant had a peculiar feature, the so-called end effect. It was that in some conditions, before deactivating, it temporarily increased the power output. The official accident investigation report even compared it to speeding up an automobile when a brake pedal is pushed. The engineers knew it well. To prevent accidents, there were strict instructions to follow, and a few levels of hardware, scram and protection circuits. However, on the 26th of April, 1986, it just wasn't enough. By the way, on the contrary to a common misconception, there was only one circuit disabled during Chernobyl accident. The Emergency Core Cooling System, ECCS. the rest of them were functioning normally. As you can see from the name, ECCS is meant not for controlling the reactor, but for abstracting the heat in case of emergency. See, reactors have a huge thermal lag. Even if the chain reaction is stopped, the reactor can't cool down instantly. The fuel assemblies still generate a lot of heat for a long time. The test regulations received from the top ordered that the system should be turned off. However, it still wouldn't help. Why? Because the experiment itself didn't go as planned. The experiment should have started the day before, on April 25th at 2 p.m. But a supervisor from Kyivenergo interfered. He demanded that the planned reactor power output decrease would be postponed as an evening power consumption peak was coming up. This person gave his permission for lowering the power output only at 11 p.m. Contrary to the plan, the reactor had been active for additional 9 hours in transit mode. Due to that fact, there formed a lot of xenon isotopes, which made controlling the reactor much harder. Experts call such reactors poisoned. However, it was decided that the experiment would go on anyway. Exactly at midnight on the 26th of April, a new reactor control shift started. The experiment went to its final phase. By 1 a.m. the power output reached the scheduled 700 megawatts. But then it started to drop quickly. The shift managed to stabilize the reactor only at 200 megawatts. This time it was the shift supervisor who decided to defy the regulations. The experiment was deliberately set up on a lower power level. It is a common misconception that there was a nuclear explosion in Chernobyl. But that is not true. The reactor blew up like an overheated pressure cooker due to the failed experiment. The experiment was supposed to check if a coaxing turbo generator was enough to supply the plant with the power for normal operation. Three previous experiments failed, but the workflow altered after that. The success promised higher security for all the RBMK reactors and pretty bonuses for all the staff. At 1:23 a.m. the experiment started. The water level in the reactor started to gradually decrease and the power output started to increase. According to the plan, the reactor was supposed to be decelerated by the control rods as normal. However, system AZ5 was off because the reactor had been working on lower energy levels prior to that. The deviation was noticed 36 seconds later. The operator pushed the AZ5 button and the control rods went to the active zone. Remember that end effect I talked about? It led to a sudden reactor power excursion. The water in the lower part of the active zone instantly turned into overheated steam and rushed outwards at pressure of 70 atmospheres. The upper part of the active zone was covered with the biological shield. It is called the Scheme E or Elena. That Elena weighed 450 tons. It was thrown up to the ceiling by the explosion. It broke a fuel loading crane and fell back on the reactor, crashing it. The first explosion was followed by a second one. It is still unclear whether it was the overheated steam or perhaps the hydrogen formed during the accident. It is not that big of a deal. The main reactor hull roof partially collapsed, while in the active zone, the graphite on the inner sides of the reactor caught fire. In Fukushima, the tragedy had been unfolding much slower. The first explosion took place 24 hours after the initial shock, after the plant had been flooded. All the time, the plant staff had been trying to restore cooling to the shut-down reactors with all the means necessary. The engineers had to act blindly. They had been struggling to restore power to the plant. Measuring equipment and reactor cooling systems were non-functional. After the blackout, water circulation system valves closed and sealed the tubes. The reactor started to overheat, but nobody seemed to know it yet. The realization started to come only at midnight. There were no instructions for such an accident, so engineers had to improvise. The lighting was partially restored thanks to a portable power generator provided by a local building company. The control panel of the third reactor was revived with 10 car batteries from the employees' cars.
and the reactor cooling was being restored by pumping water from 3 fire trucks.
The sensors detected pressure increase inside the reactor sealed shells, the containment. It seems like there had started a reaction between zirconium and overheated steam. The reaction forms hydrogen and creates a lot of heat. The engineers had a solution for that. In such case, the containment would be filled with nitrogen. It creates inert atmosphere and prevents hydrogen from exploding. But the pressure in the sealed shell of the first reactor was beyond critical. A decision was made to relieve the radioactive gas from the containment into the atmosphere. At 2 p.m. the first reactor safety valve was activated. The pressure went back to the appropriate level. But an hour and a half later, a massive explosion occurred. The hydrogen, having had come in contact with normal atmosphere, turned into a powerful explosive.
The possibility of such explosion outside of a protective shell is never taken into concern, neither by nuclear plant constructors nor by International Atomic Energy Agency safety experts. The explosion at the first reactor destroyed a part of the building and damaged the fire truck's hoses, so the engineers were facing the reactor cooling problem once again. The radiation reached a level.
The second explosion took place 4 days after the earthquake. On the 15th of March at 6 a.m., the fourth power generating unit partially collapsed. There accumulated the hydrogen from the first reactor's containment, then a random spark made it explode and started a fire. There was no explosion in the second reactor. The radioactive steam blew off the containment knockdown hatch and escaped to the atmosphere.
Only in 2011, 9 months after the accident, the reactors were set to a cold shutdown mode. The Japanese companies will start extracting the melted fuel from the damaged generating units only in 2020s.
It took Soviet experts 10 days to extinguish the fire. Unlike Fukushima, it was upstream above the scorching reactor that spread radioactive dust and heavy isotopes. During that time, shocking 380 million curie had irradiated the atmosphere. 15 million of those poured down on adjacent regions of Ukraine, Russia, Belarus, turning them into exclusion zones. The reactors detonated like a classic dirty bomb.
It took experts 6 months to build a protective cover over the collapsed generating unit. The building, commonly referred to as a sarcophagus, solved the problem of radioactive dust spread and contaminating fallout. Almost 96% of the fuel is still inside the destroyed plant building. The melted fuel mixed with the sealing concrete, reactor remains, and flow to the lower levels of the plant, solidifying in the form of giant elephant legs. This problem is yet to be solved in the future. According to different reports, the Chernobyl cauldron witnessed approximately from 600,000 to 1 million people.
The official reports state 2 people died instantly upon the explosion. Acute radiation syndrome claimed lives of 31 people, mostly the firemen that had worked on the site first. 134 have coped with the disease, becoming heavily handicapped. About 115,000 to 200,000 had to leave their homes forever.
In Fukushima tragedy, 3 people died and 20 were over-radiated, gaining 170 millisieverts. Approximate value of radioactive material then equals a quarter of that in Chernobyl, with the majority of the material contaminating in the ocean water.
Nuclear disaster control and rectification of their consequences is still a controversial topic. There are many speculations from all sources. Was the reactor extinguishing in Chernobyl carried out in the right manner? Should they have filled the active zone with lead and dust-absorbing materials? Was there an alternative to utilizing Soviet officers and soldiers? And there are plenty of questions on the accident in Japan, starting with the plant's design and on to the concealing the accident's scale.
There are many questions indeed, but I suggest we shouldn't judge. Experts had to act blindly in unprecedented situations. Finally, I'd like to mention a quote I heard from different people involved in Chernobyl accident. Only in USSR there could happen an accident like this, and only in USSR they could handle it like they did. As it turns out, they were wrong. The history tends to repeat itself, and it's no joke.